Hello, and welcome to Stewart's Chapel Baptist Church, a place where you and your family can feel right at home. Located in Flintville, Tennessee, you are always welcome here, led by Pastor Don Pierson. You will find a warm and welcoming environment here at Stewart's Chapel. Join us as we worship together.
So why would he fail now? He He won't fail. Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest rain, but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
Sing that again.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but only trust in Jesus' name.
Christ alone.
Christ alone. Cornerstone. Weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord. Seems to hide His face. I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil.
Savior's love through the storm.
Father, thank you for another time of coming in and singing these praises to you and lifting your name up. God, we pray that the rest of this service will be convicting to us, will spur us on, God. Let us be open to that. And the ones that haven't accepted you as our Lord and Savior, God, I pray that today's the day. I say this in Jesus' name. Amen.
We have been praying for you, and I know that you've dealt with a lot of sickness besides your own accident over the last 3 or 4 weeks. Your whole family has, and that baby's name is Brandon, right? Is it Brandon? Brandon. What is it? Brennan. And that baby was born last Sunday. And this family seems to take in a lot of children, and so it looks like they've decided to take this baby in, and which, my goodness. And so, a beautiful little baby there. I just went senior moment. Just totally forgot the name. So Bobby Stewart had surgery yesterday morning. She fell at her brother's funeral this week on Friday at emergency surgery. Yesterday, she's doing great. She'll be there. They've already had her up and stuff, so she broke her hip and had that done. Eric Smith and Eric and Michelle, who've been visiting with us, he has surgery on Tuesday. And then Shirley, we prayed for a little bit earlier, we'll have hip replacement surgery on Thursday. So just remember to pray for each of these. Let's pray. Father, I ask, Lord God, that you would continue to move in here. I thank you, Father, for you speaking to people and urging them and causing them to come and speak to you. Some, Lord God, asking you to work in other people's lives. Some asking you to work in their own lives. But either way, you spoke and drew them. I pray that you'll do the same thing. You'll be the same God in here. You'll be the God who draws. And that we would find ourselves being those that you are drawing, finishing and shaping what you desire in our life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to be in the Old Testament, 1 Samuel chapter 7, and then over in 2 Samuel. About, I don't even know how long it's been. It's probably been about maybe 2 months ago in one of my Monday devotions that I put on church Facebook page and as well as sent to a few others. I dealt with this passage, and when I was sitting having that devotion, I've been reading through the Samuels, and as I was reading through Samuel, this phrase, this act caught my attention and has not left me, and I felt compelled to share it with you the Sunday after Easter today. And I want to talk about you pouring out the path to revival. Before I even read the scripture, though, I want to ask a question of you. I've asked this question in different ways or been led to ask this question of you in different ways. And so this is not a new question coming from me. I want you to look at where you are right now spiritually. Not where you were, but right now. Right now, where you are spiritually. Would you say that God is smiling from ear to ear as he looks at you and says, man, girl, boy, you're on fire? Or would you say, the Lord look at you and say, oh my goodness, I'm all giddy. I'm all excited about what I see, how you're responding to me. and how you're growing. I'm excited about what I see. I see you moving and drawing near to me. You're responding to my spirit, and I see that. And if he would say something, he would say to you, just keep on going. Or would the Lord look at you and say, what's happened? Have you allowed others to affect you too much? Have you allowed your own sin to affect you too much? You're not moving towards me. You think you're the same. You think that you're just kind of read the scripture, both of them, 1 Samuel chapter 7, verse 2 through 7. So it was that the ark remained in, and by the way, often in Sunday school Wednesday night, other people will be reading scripture, and they'll come to a word, and they'll look at me like, help. By the way, Trish would be the first to tell you, if you're looking for me for help on pronunciations, you're looking in the wrong direction. And I'm about to prove it. So it was that the ark remained in Kirjath Jearim. It's acceptable to me. I don't know whether it's right. A long time. Now, how long is a long time? It was there 20 years. 20 years is a long time. And all the house of Israel lamented or mourned or grieved. In other words, all the house of Israel was stuck spiritually for 20 years. 20 years stuck. How long are you going to be that way? If you were the third person that I described and you were thinking, well, yeah, that's me. How long are you going to be like that? Well, then Samuel, and I hope that God chooses to make me a Samuel this morning. Then Samuel spoke to all the house of Israel, saying, if you return to the Lord with all your hearts, then you're going to have to put away the foreign gods and the Ashtaroths from among you. In other words, if you really want to come back to the Lord, if you're tired of just being tired and tired of being stale, dead, grieving, complaining, critical, whatever it is where you are, but you're not where God wants you to be, if you're tired of that, then you're going to have to come back to where you're supposed to be. Because you think that's where you are, but really you know down in your heart you really aren't there. If you're going to get there, you're going to have to come back with all your heart. You're going to have to let go of the things that you've been holding on. It may be past. It may be something that is ongoing. But you're going to have to let go. You're going to have to put them away from you. And you're going to have to prepare your hearts for the Lord. You're going to have to make your house, your heart ready for him to come in. Isn't that weird? Theologically, that sounds weird. There are so many reasons why I guess even long before this conversation that I had on the phone with a good friend of mine who's a theologian, I had it for an hour, and it was an hour and 40-some minutes in the parking lot at First Baptist Flintville this week. Called, I pulled over. I thought maybe it'd just be a few minutes. Oh my goodness, God used that conversation in my life this week. And I want to say to you, I don't know about you. You're thinking your life ought to be lineal. Point A, point B, point C, point D. God's will is not like that. And you know why? In Islam, God's will is like that. Everything's fate, everything destiny, everything is determined. And so it's you don't have any choice. It's just, you know, you're at point A, point B, point C. But that's not the way it is for Christians. And you know why? Because our God is Emmanuel. Our God is relational. And His will is not a straight line. His will is like a river. Because He deals with me and you. He's going to get to the destination. But He's going to walk with me along my way. And some of you, He hasn't left you. You sure have gotten cold. And He's camped out there. That's not where He wants you. He does have a will for you. That's not where He wants you. You're camped out on an island along that river. And that's not where He's intended. There'll be a flood tide that'll come. And everything on that island is going to be swept down according to His will. And you don't want that. You don't want it that way. You got to prepare your heart for the Lord. And He's not talking to lost people. He's talking to God's children, Israel. And He's saying to them, you're going to have to do some things. In other words, you can't stay there. And if you don't want to stay there, then you're going to intentionally have to return, get rid of some things, and you're going to have to do some preparation right here for the Lord to do what He wants to do. Then you're going to have to, when that happens, you're going to serve Him only. You're going to serve Him only. It's going to come to a place, a decisive moment, one of those points in the river. It's going to become such a decisive moment that when you tell your testimony, you're going to forget that your life was a river and you're going to do point A, B, C. You're going to do lineal. Because it's going to be one of those traumatic moments in your life. And I want that to happen today. I think God has been preparing me for the 8 weeks or whatever it was that I first read this for today. I think God, in a way, has sent me to be Samuel to you and to say to you, this is what has to happen in your life. That God doesn't want you there. He has something far greater for you. And so, you'll serve Him only, then He will deliver you from the hand of the Philistine. In other words, He's going to take care of the enemy you've been fighting. So the children of Israel, they put away the Baals and the Ashtaroths, and they served God only. Samuel gathered them all. So evidently, there is some distance, some time between verse 2 and 3, and then 4, there is some time for them to take what He says in 3 in order for them to do what He says in 4. And then there's another period of time for 5. Can God do it all at once? Yeah, and I'm going to tell you why I believe He can. Because I don't think today will be the first time you've heard God saying to you, look, you've been here too long. You've been at this place too long. It's not where I want you. Some of you have already been doing some of the letting go. Some of y'all have to do some of the letting go now. But then we come to verse 5. And Samuel said, gather all Israel to Mizpah. Not anybody, everybody, gather all Israel to Mizpah. And I will pray to the Lord for you. So now there is some time between verse 5 and verse 6. I want to tell you something. A long time ago, I realized that God doesn't really care a whole lot about the journey as long as you get to where he wants you. He doesn't talk a whole lot about the journey, getting there. And that's what's happening. There's a lot of time. Find that with Abraham. God says to Abraham, leave the land of Ur. Go to Canaan, the promised land. And you know what it says? It says, Abraham left and he arrived. All in one sentence. And it's like, my goodness, that's 500 miles. There's a whole lot of time in between there. But God is not always concerned about all of that as long as you get to where he wants you. And I want to tell you something. God has a place for you. And he wants you to get there. And he sends Samuel to be the man. And Samuel says, I want you all to gather at Mizpah. I'm going to pray for you when you get there. Well, in verse 6. So they gathered. I don't know how long that takes. I don't know whether that takes a few days, a week, a month. I don't know. I don't know whether there was some PowerPoint slides being sent out, whether it was a phone tree or something that went out and said, hey, you're going to have to be here at such and such time. We're going to be waiting for you. But regardless, they all moved. So they gathered together at Mizpah. Drew water. And they poured it out. They poured it out before the Lord. And they fasted that whole day. And they said there, we have sinned against the Lord. And Samuel judged the children of Israel at Mizpah. Wait a second. I thought he was going to pray over them when he got to Mizpah. I didn't hear anything about him judging the people at Mizpah. When did he pray for them? I'm sure he did. The prayer is not recorded, nor the fact that he prayed is even stated. That wasn't the most important thing. The idea of judging them is that God used Samuel to take them from where they were, where God wanted them to be. That's the whole point. Jump over to second. Save your finger there because we'll be back in there. But sometimes Scripture will interpret Scripture. And this is one of those cases where God interprets what the pouring out of the water meant. And so in 2 Samuel chapter 14, verse 14, it says this. Or we will surely die and become like water spilled on the ground, which cannot be gathered up again. Yet God does not take away life, but he devises plant means so that his banished ones are not expelled from him. What's this pouring out of the water? What's that mean? What's the significance of pouring out water? I mean, what kind of religious ritual is that? How in the world does that have anything to do with repentance? Why has that anything to do with revival among God's people? Well, let me remind you, Israel was birthed in the wilderness. They was birthed in the desert place. More than once, they complained about not having water. And water and the giving of water was God's instrument over and over again of either taking water that was bitter and making it sweet or bringing water out of places where water didn't seem to be. Water was life for them. Elijah does the same thing on Mount Carmel. It's been 3.5 years without rain. All the rivers, all the streams, everything is dried up. It is so bad that the king of Israel at the time has sent out people all over the land looking for any kind of water and to bring it back. Elijah, the prophet at that time, the Samuel at that time, calls all of God's people not to Mizpah, but to Mount Carmel. He tells them basically the same thing. You guys are. He not only builds back the altar, he not only gets it ready, he not only has the sacrifice on there, he takes these barrels of water. Now remember, water is more precious than anything at that time. And he orders whatever water they have been brought to them to be poured out on the altar. Be poured out, not to be gathered up. To you and I, or to them who had been going out everywhere trying to find water, and they're bringing water with them because their people are everywhere, when they watch him pour out barrel after barrel of water on that altar and watch it sink into that dry desert ground, they're thinking, sort of like Judas, what a waste. What a waste. But life. But life is found in the water. Not just the blood. Larry talked about the spear. Remember what comes out? Blood and water. Water in Scripture is a symbol of life, just as we saw in 2 Samuel, about pouring out your whole life. It's a sacrifice. Mizpah. Let's talk about Mizpah. There are four. Would least think of the other three. This is the Mizpah of Benjamin, the least of all the tribes. Mizpah of Benjamin. What does Mizpah mean? When a Jew heard the word Mizpah, what did they hear? Well, it meant a place of a witness. Mizpah meant the place of witness. It's a witness before you and God. Or, there's two different meanings, it's a place of witness or it's a place of worship. And they combine the two in this one place. And a place of worship becomes a place of witness, not only to God, but to all that it was present. And all that was present, watch, 20 years of being away and a deadness change to life. But what you don't know is that the book of Judges precedes this. And in the book of Judges, it records a cycle that is repeated 13 times in the book of Judges. From generation after generation, and Samuel inherits this cycle. What is that cycle? The people of God sin. They sin by turning to other gods. When they sin, they turn to other gods. God judges them. He sends discipline, and it's severe discipline on them because they sin by turning to other means for the fulfillment of their life. Because their life no longer is in God. They're no longer pouring out their life into God. They're now pouring out their life into everything else that entertains and satisfies their self and flesh. So they sin. They turn to other things for what they're supposed to get from God. God judges or disciplines them. They cry out for mercy. God sends a deliverer, or as it is called in the book of Judges, a judge. And that judge doesn't really judge them. That judge ends up being a deliverer who ends that cycle. And that cycle is ended during that period of that deliverer. But that deliverer dies, and what do? They do it again. They sin. God disciplines. They cry out. God sends a deliverer. They do it again 13 times. So when you come to this passage in Samuel, God's going to do an incredible thing, something that none of the other deliverers is going to do. This cycle is going to come to an end and will last not only through that generation, the next generation, and the third generation. And it's going to last through David's reign. And it's not going to be reintroduced until David's son Solomon. Here's the question. If you were like the third person I described, is this the first time you've been there? Probably not. It may be the worst. It may be the longest. And it may be looking like to even go on much farther if you do not hear, heed, and hear his voice. But I guarantee it, this is not the first time you've been here, been to this place. So God does an incredible thing. He chooses and calls out a prophet named Samuel. And he has them stand before the people. He says to them, first meeting, you return to God. Go home and you get break everything that holds you, that you are dearer to in your heart than God, and you get your heart ready. And you come to the place where others will gather with you who have the same kind of heart. Place of witness, and you will stand before me. You will have already returned unto me. You have already cleansed your life of the things that need to be cleansed. You will have made ready for the next step. When you get there, now that you're there, prophet, players for you to pour out your life. You can't dig it in here. You're going to pour it out where you can't get it again. You're not going to put it over in the bank or put it in storage or someplace where you can return to it. You're going to pour it out where there's no way you can find it again, because all you're going to pick up is some wet dirt. You're not going to be able to drink it. And you don't put muddy water back in your pot. You leave it alone. You pour it out in such a way that you cannot pick it up. And the second thing is, you can't hear this. You don't leave any swishing. Don't you leave any swishing. You pour it all out. Every drop. You let it get all out of you. Don't keep any. Don't hold on to any of it. Don't compromise. Don't try to convince yourself that you need a little bit of swishing in your life. You get rid of it. And then the enemy's going to come. Just like he did before. You're going to have a little bit of fear when he does, just like they did. You are different. And the enemy is going to quickly realize you're not the same. He's not going to be able to plunder you. He's not going to be able to plunder you like he did before. This time when he comes, he's not only going to be leaving empty-handed, he's going to be leaving bruised, battered, having his head stomped on. I got two more pages of notes up there. As you can tell, I haven't even looked at them. I think I'm where I'm supposed to be. I am not Samuel. I am Don Pierson, and I am nowhere near a Samuel. All I deliver to you is what I believe and have prayed for and through. I deliver to you what I really believe God wants me to deliver to you. I know that if you were the last person I described, you know that is not where God wants you, is it? You are in your mitzvah. You are in your place of worship. You have chosen this place for your place of worship. You are before your witnesses. Most of all, you know. You look up the phrase pouring out, you'll find some interesting thing. When it talks about Jesus on the cross, and even before that, in Philippians, it says that Jesus emptied himself. There was no swishing left in Jesus. Poured out himself for you and I. When it talks about the Holy Spirit coming to us, the phrase is he poured out his Spirit on us. Then it goes on. The rest of them are about us. Paul says, I am being poured out every day. For those who don't tithe, he says, you want me to pour out my blessings on you? Then you better start tithing. By the way, he knows the difference. In Titus, it says that God has poured out his blessing on his children that are faithful. Here's the bottom line. No swishing. You hear me? You understand that language? That's a Pearson, Don Pearson, thank God inspired phrase for now. No swishing. Pour out your life. You say, well, I did that. You picked it up. Don't go back to the dirt. Pick up the dirty water. Don't do that. Pour it out and you empty the vessel. You return to him. You get away from everything that catches. Being all that God really wants you to be. You know. Some of them are escapes for you. Some of you, they're distractions. Some of them, they have become your mizpah, your safe place. I don't know what they are for you, but I do know one thing. God has chosen this day. Say this word. The question is, will you respond like Israel did? Will you pour out? Will you empty yourself because yourself is the vessel? After this kind of revival is only found by emptying. And he'll pour in. Father, you take your word and you stir.
Thank you for joining us today at Stewart's Chapel Baptist Church in Flintville, Tennessee. We're grateful you watched the service today and hope you find it uplifted. Remember, you're always welcome here at Stewart's Chapel. Until we meet again, may God be with you.